This right here? No.
No. If you go to like share screen, like click on that.
Oh, advanced.
Advanced. And music over.
Well, if I need to share something else, will it let me when I stop this?
You're just the kind of crazy I've been carrying for. And when you
exit out of that. Alright. Carry me away. When the sun hits my face, I'll defy. Carry me away. Carry me. All good. You guys look great. Good morning.
Good morning.
Can you hear? I'm playing a little music.
We can hear it.
Yes.
Right. Yeah.
You know. Design week. Let's get the mood.
Yeah, it's fine. It's fine.
Do you all have a good weekend?
We did. I did. Yeah, sure did. How about yourself?
Yeah, it was nice. Caught some extra little sun there. I wasn't expecting. So
I know. Sunday, I mean, yeah, I took my rain jacket thinking it was going to be a rainy weekend in Seattle. And Sunday was absolutely
surprise.
Gorgeous.
Yeah. So we'll just wait for Casey here and then we'll get started. Truth it isn't easy, the truth it has a cost. The truth is being censored, the truth is I implore that for me. It's not easy to do when I have nothing to win and have everything to lose. Don't get caught up letting the news tear each other apart. Fears making money, doing nothing for us, nothing for us, nothing for us. Don't get caught up letting the news tear each other apart. Fear's been making money, doing nothing for us, nothing for us, nothing for us. If anyone is interested in this music, it is Spotify Jack Johnson Radio.
Oh, okay.
Well, I knew it had that Jack Johnson vibe to it.
Yeah. texted Casey, but we talked about it in our morning meeting, so I know he knows about it.
Oh, he'll be here.
Lily will be right there too. So.
Yeah. Just to let everybody know, signing on, we're almost full at capacity, which is very exciting, and we will be having a quick Q&A at the end. And then we'll be doing announcing our winner live for the giveaway.
Do you live inside outside me?
Turn the music down a little bit. There's Casey. Or, hi.
Morning.
We got two of you.
Uh-oh.
My name's on there twice. How's that?
How you doing, Gina?
I'm good. How are you?
Good.
Do you want me to rename you or you got it? I can do it.
Oh, Lily, I just kind of leave.
Boom.
Okay, I'm going to leave and come back. Oh, you fixed it.
You got it. I got you.
Thank you.
Yeah. All right, everybody. We are coming up on time here to start. And let me, I can leave the, can you hear the music still? I turned it way down, but we
real
might just.
Real light, very light. In the
real
back.
Light?
Yeah.
Morning, Whitney.
Good morning, Casey. How are you?
Good, how are you?
I'm good, thank you.
Okay. There we go. And let me get going here. Good morning, everybody.
Morning.
Thank you for joining us for our launch presentation of our intentional living panel. Today we have Casey Roloff, CEO and founder of Seabrook, Stephen Palacos.
You got
I've
it.
Been crack. I did. Okay, good. Director of Town Planning and Design, and Whitney Wiggins, the new interior designer for the Seabrook team. We're very excited to have all three Yay. Of you here. Thank you so much. So I want to start off quickly. Again, I'm going to repeat myself because we had some more people join. We're going to do a Q&A at the end. So please put your questions into the Q&A portion, not into the chat. And then also we'll be doing our giveaway at the end live. So please stay tuned because we're really excited about that. So to get started, I'm Gina Clucci with the Seattle Design Center. And first question here, I want to ask all three of you to kind of get us started. What does intentional living mean to you? Casey, do you want to start?
Well, I think for us, just even before we got into all of this, it was just having a more relaxed, casual, simple life. I mean, we just wanted to have a simple life. I certainly found a way to complicate it, but I think that what we wanted, we realized that a lot of other people wanted, you know, being able to walk to work and having kids walk to school and just these things that are simple. It just makes our life a lot more, it makes it easier and more fun. And we're not going in every direction. It's all very, I guess a very small footprint. We live on a very small footprint and that just makes our life less complicated.
Yeah. Intentional.
And intentional. Yeah.
All right. Stephen, do you want to chime in there? What does intentional living mean to you?
Yeah. As a designer, of course, I really love to be surrounded by beautiful things. And we're blessed to have so many great designers that work in and around Seabrook. So being able to see all that creative work in one place and engage with it on a daily basis is just a real, real gift.
Great. And Whitney?
Yeah, I think for me, intentional living and intentional design means really seeking out the things that inspire you, seeking out the things that you love, that you are passionate about, and making space for that
in your life. I think so often we tend to get caught up in work and daily routines and the things that we have to do that we forget about the things that really, really inspire us, both as designers and as people. And being intentional about creating that space for the things that are important to you is really what kind of living intentionally means to me.
It's beautiful. Beautiful. Great. So next, you know, Casey, you've created this town, this beautiful place, from the very beginning. Can you give us a little background on the art of town building? And I have some photos too. Do you want to share? You are co-host, or I can share them.
If you could share that, that's, I mean, yeah, I'm not sure how I would share them. I don't know where they are. So if you've got them, yeah, that would be great.
Okay, let me get those up really quick.
I guess just getting started. I mean, I think one of the things that surprises people is that we're not doing anything new here. We would love to tell people that we invented this idea of building a town and we would look so smart, but in reality, all we're doing is following the same methodology that was used to build and design and build the most beautiful towns, villages, and cities in the world. And the sad thing was it was forgotten. We were incredibly sophisticated designers and town builders all before the automobile was introduced. And that's really where there was this paradigm shift from designing really intentional spaces and beautiful places. And we started to design at an automobile scale. So we shifted from that, you know, focus on the pedestrian experience, and we started to focus on more of an automobile experience and how our lives would change with the automobile. And now I think a lot of people are looking back and going, I don't know if that experiment worked out as well as we all hoped, you know, just our commuting times and having to rely on our cars every single day when we used to live a life where we didn't need cars. So.
And do you want to go into where you kind of started, where you pulled some of this information and?
So, my wife and I, after we finished college, moved down to, we were in Tacoma at University of Puget Sound, and moved down to the Central Oregon coast. And actually there was a book that came out in the 90s called The Not So Big House. That was the author was Susan Sasanka, and she wrote about designing more intentional spaces because our house sizes had gotten so much bigger. And it was more on volume of space and dollar per square foot. She brought back these kind of principles of how we design houses more intentionally, using space more wisely, and actually putting more attention into the detail. So instead of, it's definitely a more expensive way to build. It's, a higher dollar per square foot, but the quality and the experience it creates inside the home is really beautiful. So we use some of those design principles, design our first house in 1995. And then it just kind of snowballed. People saw our houses and we started just designing and building homes. So it was in 5 years later, in 2000, that's when we learned about this new town that was started on the Florida coast and the panhandle between Destin and Panama City. And they were really the ones that picked up the art of town building out of the garbage can, because I think there was this feeling, that from developers, like, oh yeah, we used to do that, and we're doing it differently now, and that was the old way, this is the new way. And so they realized that the new development just didn't measure up to places like, you know, they're on the East Coast, like places like Nantucket and Martha's Vineyard and Charleston and even little towns like Key West, St. Augustine. These towns were, they were beautiful 150 years ago, and they're even more beautiful now and more desirable yeah. now. So they're like, why did we stop doing this? So that's that inspired us. So Seaside was a massive success. Probably it was Design of the Decade in Time magazine. Even though most people from the Northwest don't even know about it. But people travel all around the world to study Seaside. If you're an architect or you're in urban planning right. you know, school or something, you learn about it. But a lot of people just haven't heard about it. So that inspired us essentially to get into the placemaking business and bringing back these principles that were used building great places. So we started on the Oregon coast and then moved up here because we saw, you know, we decided we'd build a town from scratch after our first success on the Oregon coast called Bella Beach. And we saw this, you know, again, this massive market that had been untapped in the Puget Sound, you know, where like Oregon has, they've got several great beach towns, you know, Cannon Beach, Gearhart, Manzanita, I can go down the coast. But Washington didn't have that go-to beach town. Mm-hmm. And so many people from the Puget Sound were driving down to the Oregon coast. So it's, you know, what's driven this place are just demographics. Huge demand and, you know, very little to no supply. So we bought, you know, now we own about 500 acres and we're basically now building out that supply. And making it Washington's beach town rather than having to drive to Oregon's beach towns.
Well, we're very lucky for that. And I'm actually, I think because I shared my audio, now I can't get my screen to share, so.
Oh, okay.
That's where we're at.
Yeah.
If Lily is there, she probably can get the photos up.
Okay, yeah, I'll grab her super quick.
However, why don't we keep going? Because I want people to see the before and after. I think it's fascinating.
So the basic principles of building a town from scratch is, you know, meeting all the basic needs of a resident, in our case, also a guest, within a 5 to 10 minute walk. So making it super mm-hmm. easy to get around town is paramount, right? So the second principle is building a lot of types of housing, a lot of diversity in housing types, and making the place very inclusive. So you could be eating in a restaurant in Seabrook and, you know, one of the servers that's serving you could live in a little apartment above a garage, but then you've also got the multimillionaire that has a mansion and there's everything in between, but they all know each other by name. And our towns, instead of, you know, what suburbia created, we segmented people based on what they could afford. And so you don't see that. You don't see the server, you know, catching up with the millionaire. So having that diversity just builds really strong communities. But it also having that diversity in art and size and scale and architecture helps shape the pedestrian experience. So you're not just seeing 3,500 square foot houses in a row. Over, you know, with three different colors, you're actually seeing all these different shapes, sizes, textures, colors. So it's not just about walking from point A to point B. We want that experience to be incredible enough to where you want to go to point A to point B, and then you want to go to C and D and E. You want to wander around the town. So that diversity really helps. And then the third principle, which is most important, I don't know if you can see my screen now, but
yep.
The third
thank you, Lily.
The third principle is what's called the transect. And you can actually see that here where we put the most density in the center of the town. And that's the most urban place, you know, about 20 homes per acre, you know, concrete sidewalks, more intense infrastructure. But as you come away from the town, you can see the trees and the open space, a lot more natural surroundings. And so instead of 20 homes per acre, it gets to, you know, 10 to 5 to 1 home per acre. So more elbow room as you go out of town. And that architecture is going from a more formal design to a more casual design and more natural design as you walk away from the town. So once again, this is all about the pedestrian experience. And if you go into, you know, historic towns like Nantucket, or if you go into places in, you know, great old towns in Europe, you will see this transect in place where every street feels different than the next. And that's the whole, you know, that's the artistic side of placemaking and town building. So,
what's your population right now?
Our population, you know, of course, COVID has increased that population. We were at about 10% of our homeowners, you know, before the pandemic hit. But now, of course, a lot of people are selling their homes in Seattle and Puget Sound, and actually move, you know, a lot of our homeowners are moving out here full time. This is becoming their primary residence. So I think we're probably closer to 20% right now. And a lot of the homes we're selling are people that are going to be living more of that hybrid lifestyle, where they can live in a more sustainable kind of community the majority of the time, but then drive, you know, a couple days a week, you know, maybe stay the night in a hotel or at a friend's house and work a couple of days in the city at headquarters, and then come back out and live at the beach.
That's great. Sorry, you can keep going and show.
Okay. Yeah.
Photos. So, I know that. So.
And I'm, there we go. So this is actually, where is this, Stephen? Is this Cape Cod? I'm not sure.
Actually not sure.
Well, this is just showing another.
I think it is Cape Cod. It could be private town.
It's another historic town. I mean, I think what we're showing is like, and again, a lot of these great old towns are on the East Coast because it was earlier before the automobile. So the West Coast, while we have some great towns, you know, La Jolla, Laguna Beach, Park City, Telluride, Port Townsend, you know, LeConnor, Langley, all of these, you know, these are all places, you know, in the Northwest and on the West Coast that have those fundamental principles of walkability and mixed use and residential all in the same area. So again, this is a great shot of Port Townsend. Again, just showing the town center, got the little chapel up on the hill, you know, the green here, the marina. Yeah. This is amazing stuff, but you just don't see it anymore in new development. And again, the architecture, a lot of different styles, textures, colors that make a place like Port Townsend a real destination. This is just showing that transect from the urban core to the natural edge. And again, creating, taking the buildings and organizing them in a way where you create these outdoor rooms and you're framing these outdoor experiences. A lot of people, you know, buy the house or they buy in a location. But when it comes to these types of towns, you're buying what's outside the walls. It's how these buildings surround these outdoor rooms, you know, our streets, our squares, our parks. And that's where you really want to be. You want to be hanging out in those outdoor spaces. It's just showing, you know, the beginnings of our town center. We have about 20 shops and restaurants and a lot more coming. We're only about a third of the way there as far as building, building our town center. And notice how the residential is up above. Our, you know, main streets are a lot more vibrant when they have residential above retail. This is our little grocery store. We started by incubating businesses with temporary buildings. So a lot of people come here and they think that these are permanent buildings, but these are actually temporary. They'll be replaced by, you know, permanent retail with residential up above. Just some of the beautiful pathways around town, along Stevens. These are all, this is Stevens' work here. Just through these great little parks and yeah. open spaces. And you
notice
Oh, notice how this little tower is creating a terminated vista. So when you're walking down that pathway and when you're walking down streets and alleys, there are these terminated vistas and deflected vistas around town, little courtyards with cottages surrounding. 60% of our houses do not front streets. They actually front these outdoor rooms, courtyards, parks, and pathways, which is obviously a lot more sustainable because we have less impervious surface. When you try to reduce the street, you actually reduce the amount of impervious surface, which is better for the environment. But it's also just great to live. This is a new house that was just built.
Gorgeous.
Designed by Bayless Architects. And Stephen, the interior designer.
I believe this is Amy Baker.
Yeah. Amy Baker, but just a spectacular new oceanfront house that we built in our Elk Creek neighborhood.
If I'm not mistaken, it's going to be on the cover of one of the lifestyle magazines that we're not allowed to say.
Exciting.
It's coming up.
And this
keep
is
an
actually,
eye out for it.
This is actually the Coastal Living Magazine Idea House. This is in our first oceanfront neighborhood. Really beautiful house designed by Lou Oliver.
And that interior designer was Tim Clark. From down in California.
Yeah. These are the views there through this. So again, you can see how we seamlessly weave the natural environment in with the built environment. And that's a really important part.
Well, that's a perfect segue too to my next question is, you know, design is a form of art in all forms and fashions. And, you know, Stephen being the director of design, how does that apply to the way you think about planning Seabrook?
Right. Well, you know, it obviously starts with that town plan, and that's the most paramount thing. And when we broke ground 17 years ago, July in 2004, we chose our Pacific Glen Oceanfront neighborhood, and that's exactly where we started. And our mission, as Casey points out from the very beginning, was to seamlessly nestle a beach town into a coastal forest, but by concentrating that footprint of town development on a much smaller segment of land than what typically would be done by most developers. So that allows for a better engagement with nature and avoids the suburban sprawl kind of model of development that has unfortunately become such a condition of American life. And I think, you know, COVID just changed everything and, you know, allowed people to begin to see how important, you know, family connections were, and then begin to question, why am I in my car for how many hours a day going here and there?
Yep.
So for us, you know, it's the ultimate green of creating a compact footprint, and just feels like the most responsible way to develop. And so the concept is known as new urbanism, and it puts an enormous amount of importance on pedestrian and bicycle mobility in and around town. And as Casey mentioned, we've studied many of the greatest historic waterfront villages and towns around the Pacific Northwest, as well as the country and world, as a model for looking at how we design Seabrook. And everything's designed around that 5 or 10 minute walk of all the daily needs. So that's very intentional in how you design your day, you know. So again, minimal commute, but more time with spouses and families and friends. And again, COVID has really changed that considerably for us. And Casey mentioned the idea of the transect and how we design that continuum from the most urban of the town center to the most rural aspect of the farm district. And, you know, our design challenge is how you make that interesting from a pedestrian standpoint that entire way. So all of our paths and public spaces, multiple parks of different sizes and scales, you know, plays into this idea of where in town it's located, but trying to offer a little bit of something for everybody. Some people prefer the urban condo looking out to the ocean, which we're designing and developing and going to be releasing here soon. So stay tuned. And some people want a little bit more breathing room, so they'll have a little larger of a house or a lot in the farm district where they have some gardening space. So again, the most important design challenge there is how to make it pedestrian, for a pedestrian, you know, the most engaging and beautiful place that it can be. And for me as a designer, you know, I really, really greatly enjoy the collaboration between architects, interior designers, landscape architects and designers. I certainly don't want everything from my hand. I think towns are way more interesting when it includes many, many people in that process and that design aspect. It's just the town has more layers and more interest. And that's something that we've really enjoyed throughout the years of designing and developing Seabrook, is making a purposeful kind of design of how you use your house, from taking morning coffee on an east balcony or bay window to enjoying a sunset, you know, engagement with neighbors on your front porch, or in one of the little parks that's in each individual neighborhood that we've carefully designed. One of those great collaborations was with Brian Paquette, who I know is, I think he's speaking Wednesday, Sunset Magazine Idea House or Idea Town, where we did a collection of four houses here in Seabrook and in our Northwest Glen neighborhood. And, you know, I enjoyed my time working with Brian on designing the courtyard with that house. And then we worked with another architect group, BC&J Architects, Peter Brockvogel and Stella Caruso, and came up with a modern interpretation of a traditional home here in Seabrook, which was really quite fun for Seabrook, and added a new dimension and a new kind of layering of depth to the architectural style. And I think Brian actually just finished another house for one of our owners, so excited to kind of make a little walkthrough on that and look forward to hearing what he has to say on Wednesday.
Yeah, well, thank you. And that's a perfect segue to Whitney, as you know, bringing on, growing that team of diverse design talents. Whitney, I know you're kind of new to the Seabrook team. Do you have a specific moment that you remember when you fell in love with Seabrook?
I do. So I've been a part of the Seabrook team officially for about a month now, but I began visiting Seabrook in 2009, and then my husband and I had the opportunity to become homeowners in 2013. So I've been able to experience Seabrook from kind of all sides now, coming as a guest versus homeownership out there, and now being able to be kind of on that other side, seeing how this kind of Seabrook magic is created. And for me, the moment I fell in love with Seabrook was almost instantaneous. We had gone out, my mom actually said, we found this amazing place on the coast and you guys have to come out. And I think going back to what Casey had talked about with Washington not really having that kind of dedicated beach town, I have to admit, I was a little skeptical. She was very excited. She really, really wanted us to come out. And when we came out, I was instantly blown away. I think even in Seabrook's early years, even in kind of those first 5 years, the design intent was so clear. You could see that design and the human experience and how people interact with the environment, with the architecture, and with the interiors really was forefront. It's what was driving the town. And even though it had been 5 years, it felt like Seabrook had been there forever. And I remember I went home that Sunday and I actually sent my resume to the architect, one of the architects out at Seabrook. I never heard back, but it worked out in the end. But I was so captivated by this idea of town building and creating something for people, for the people of Washington, really kind of out of nothing. And I knew that magic was there right away. And I think just watching the town continue to grow, watching this incorporation of different types of architecture, bringing in condos and bringing in, you know, more acreage and creating this inherently very like people-centric and very kind of experience-driven place, the magic kind of never really stops. As kind of corny as that sounds, I kind of liken it to, you know, I've walked on that beach 1,000 times and it's never the same beach, right? As the tide comes and goes, it changes the landscape. Well, I've walked around Seabrook 1,000 times and it's always changing. There's always something new to discover. There's a new walkway, there's a new home, there's always something new to see. And so being able to see that change in growth, but knowing that deep down what's really driving this is kind of that human connection and that human experience is what makes it such a special place for me.
That's amazing. I'm going to share real quick because we're getting people want to see the interiors again. And so I'm going to flip through because it actually ties into the next question beautifully as well. And now, Whitney, all I'm thinking about is walking on that beach, and that's what I want to be doing. Well, besides being here with you, everyone else. So, and so we've been talking a lot about, you know, how the outside space and the inside all kind of like work together with the environment that you're in. Can you chat about how you apply these theories and this way of living to the interior of the home?
Yeah, absolutely. Again, Casey and Stephen both mentioned these concepts of these outdoor rooms in Seabrook. And I think that's what makes it such a unique space, right? You can walk through and there's these pocket parks, there's these large spaces to gather. You walk around the town during the day, people are out enjoying this environment in a million different ways, right? People are walking dogs, they're riding bikes, they're eating outside, or they're visiting the retail. And one of my favorite things to do, one of my favorite times to walk around Seabrook is at night, around that dinner hour. And you start to see people retreat back inside. And you can see families cooking dinner. You can see kids playing games. There is such a strong visual connection between the outside and the inside. You're able to really see how people are using the interior. And I know that the open concept has gotten kind of a bad rap in this year of COVID and everybody having to work and teach and learn kind of all on the same dining room table. But I think having these open concept homes really, really works out here because it creates a sense of communal gathering. It creates places for multi-generational families to come together and to cook together, to play games together, to really enjoy their time together. And so by creating these homes of varying different scales, so for here, for example, you're seeing the Alder cottages here, these are a two bedroom home, you can comfortably have a family of four or six, right? They can come and gather. Or if it's just two of you, there's a space for you. If there's 18 of you, if it's a family gathering, there's a home designed for you as well. And so, just bringing in kind of that concept of gathering that is really prevalent in the exterior and bringing that through in the interior as well, is providing people spaces to come together and spend time with one another. And I think too, bringing that exterior in through the choice of materiality. There is a clear and deliberate choice when the exteriors of a home for Seabrook are chosen, right? That we want these houses to feel like they're a part of the environment. And with that, with the time and with this kind of intentional selection comes this beautiful patina. You get this wear, you know, the coastal weather can be a little harsh sometimes, right? But what it gives it is this sense of place and belonging. And so we really try to create that with the interiors as well, using materials that feel right to the coastal environment, using a lot of woods, using natural stones, using these materials that again, carry that concept of the exterior inside and we'll get that same patina over time. What I really, really love, I've had the opportunity to stay in a number of different houses at Seabrook, is that each one feels inherently unique. Even though you're staying in a home in this same town, you don't get that feeling of being in a hotel room, right? You know that every hotel room is exactly the same. No, nothing against any hospitality designers in the audience. You guys do an amazing job. But what we encourage our homeowners to do and what we see really works is you get this very personalized sense. You start to get a lot of character in each home. And just like you're getting that character on the exterior, you know, bringing in again, that character on the interior as well to make it feel really special and really unique.
I just to add to that, I mean, I don't know how to pronounce it, but you know, it's the art of cozy. Is it the Norwegians that were, Scandinavia where they have this, it's a hig. I don't know how to pronounce it. It's like H-Y-G-G-E.
Yeah.
But I think that, you know, in this environment, like so much of what people love about it is the extremes. Like you, when the sun comes out, everybody's out walking, everybody's on the, you know, going on the beach, riding bikes. But when it rains or we have a big storm coming in, that's like part of the fun here is just kind of the, you know, the cozy aspect of it. So the homes, you know, I think you really have to have that, you know, design that cozy into the houses for this lifestyle.
I mean, I'm just looking at this and it makes me want to be there. And like you said, with my family and everyone, these great rooms you can enjoy together, or you can be together but not interacting and still enjoying your time. Mm-hmm. I think that's really important. I guess what's kind of quick question that was on my mind, you know, this past year has really made us reimagine and inspect how we're living. What's next for Seabrook and intentional living?
I think it's just, I mean, you know, we were already headed in this direction, you know, making Seabrook more livable, more sustainable, so that it, you know, because a town doesn't just get built overnight. It's an evolution. And I always use the example of like, we're kind of like in the town building process, we're kind of like an awkward teenager, meaning, you know, we haven't fully matured yet. But the town, as it builds out and fully matures, it's going to become more and more livable. So like we're focused on the medical side right now. We're focused on wellness. You know, we're adding a 10,000 square foot grocery store. And, you know, we hired the same designer that has designed the metropolitan markets in Seattle. So all these little
the school expansion too.
Yeah. Expanding our school to really support the hybrid learning aspect, where it's actually going to be positioned in our farm district next to our barn and where the horses and the ducks and, you know, the chickens and all that are. So, and the kids can actually, it's also next to our community garden. They'll have their own greenhouse. So that's going to be a more of an outdoor school. But they'll of course have an indoor classroom, but they'll be outside a lot. And all of those, I mean, I think that's the direction where a lot of the world is heading is again, kind of simplification, instead of these, you know, giant schools, you know, really, really, connecting with the outdoors and our environment and, you know, learning more about it. And so we can protect it.
And a lot of our lots, especially in the farm district neighborhood, they're a little bit larger. So they allow for ancillary structures and carriage houses or garages with little flats above them. And I think a lot of people are interested in this idea of like those become their new offices. So they right. Their commute is from their back door to their backyard, and that's it. And they get to kind of have their digital kind of connection to whatever company they might be working for digitally. And
shared works, you know, shared workspaces. So those people that live, you know, live and work here and can work online, they still might like the camaraderie of going to an office and, you know, having that social aspect. So having shared workspaces, but all within a walking distance or biking distance from their house is pretty attractive.
And yeah, we also
run home for lunch and, you know, head back.
Yeah. And we've also been incorporating little kitchen gardens into the landscape so that people can kind of have fresh herbs and vegetables and things like that, that they can cook right in their kitchen. And they know exactly where they came from and they don't have to worry about going to the market if it's not there for them at the moment. So, yeah.
I mean, it sounds kind of idyllic or utopic almost. And we kind of have to like stop ourselves every once in a while because it is. I mean, that's why we're doing this. But mm-hmm. Once again, this isn't anything new. This isn't like some new crazy idea. This is the same way we built the best places in the world. And we're just putting it back into practice in an incredible location.
Yeah. So if, you know, our our listeners here, mostly interior designers, architects, design curious, if they like what they're hearing and they want to, maybe they're not ready to make the move to Seabrook, what are some ways they can incorporate, you know, these theories and standards and ideas into their own home or space?
Well, I think for one, I would getting here and seeing it in person and learning, you know, just kind of about these principles, so that if you do have any, influence on developers and home builders, to start to think about this different way of developing. I think that's, you know, primary, because it starts there. When it comes into the design element, I mean, I think it's just even helping someone pick a location where to live. Being within walking distance of a shop or a coffee shop or a school, and also having natural open space. I think when people see this, a lot of people go back and go like, wow, you know, Ballard or Queen Anne or, you know, a lot of these old neighborhoods that have a lot of these principles, they see the value in that, and versus, you know, again, a community where there's no retail, there's no shops or restaurants within walking distance. You know, an interesting thing on that is like the scale of houses have just like dramatically increased over time. And it's mostly driven by suburbia because they don't have these things within walking distance. So instead of going to the coffee shop, we have like, you know, latte stations in our houses. And instead of having a, you know, being able to walk to the corner pub, now we've got big, you know, we have bars. And instead of walking to the movie theater, now we have like home theaters. But that's all driven by the lack of third places or, you know, places that we can walk to, shops and restaurants, from our house. So our house has just got dramatically bigger. But if you're within a close proximity and walking distance, you don't need the big house. You can actually live in a much smaller house because right. You have all these public spaces to utilize.
Which helps you make afford the details that make beautiful smaller houses so much more interesting, which is right. Why we like those really great little smaller footprint houses that have been such a mainstay of American great neighborhoods.
Yeah. And you can make, you know, with a little bit smaller space, you can make each area in your home that much more special.
Mm-hmm. And just having that front porch connection. I mean, I've seen some pretty amazing renovations of, you know, suburban houses where they've actually pulled, you know, incorporated a front porch so that they can have that connection with their neighbors. And that's what it's all about here, is just helping connect people. Doesn't mean that your whole life is public. You can still have a really private backyard. And because you need to have, it's important to have the privacy, but you also want to have that public side. And I think it's that public side that a lot of people are missing to connect with their neighbors. And so like bringing that back into the home design, or it could even be in a renovation, that's a really important piece.
And for you landscape designers out there, get in early and get your budget kind of set aside instead of waiting to the very end.
Don't skip on the outside. That's
curb appeal.
Yeah, that's great. Whitney, do you have any input on that kind of final question of how can people apply this to their own home?
Yeah, I think so. I think it's taking those, again, it's kind of going back to that initial statement about, you know, what is intentional design. I think it's taking the things that really inspire you. It's taking the things that are important to you and carving out space for them in your home. It's finding these materials that wear well, that last forever, that develop that patina to give your space that really lived in and cozy and comfortable feel. And finding those things again that you really, really love. That can last a lifetime, that can kind of be a part of your daily life and you know, not just today, but 10, 15 years from now too.
Quality.
Yes.
Great. So I'm going to open up. I'm going to actually stop sharing my screen really quick, even though these, you know, interiors are much more interesting to look at than people faces, but And I'm going to go to our Q&A. So if anybody has a question, please pop it into the Q&A section. And let's see here. This is a great first question. Are there accommodations for people with disabilities or accessibility options?
Definitely. We have a lot of homeowners that have family members who need full accessibility. And so we've designed and built houses to accommodate them. But Seabrook in itself is very accessible with our sidewalks, our streets. Because they're designed at a pedestrian scale, you can walk, ride your bike, or be in a wheelchair all around town, you know, very, very comfortably and easily. And I think that it's actually very attractive to people who need more accessibility.
Many of our parks and public spaces in particular, we, you know, as you, especially as you head out into the transect part of the neighborhood, we have curbs in the streets so that literally the street level and the level of the park is all at one level. So it just makes for an easy transition right into the public space from, you know, the pass and path trails that connect everyone.
Great, that's fantastic. Next question, and this is to Casey, and from Marcella, and she wants to know, I have a home one town over in Pacific Beach. I want to make it an intention to go to Seabrook every time I'm in town. I love the community. Have you thought of doing a very small scale artist community of several small one-room cottages that artists can buy or rent to make art and support each other?
You know, great question. And this kind of goes back to the fact that we're still a teenager in our growth. Yeah. And the next real layer here is the arts. So actually our largest block in the town center, is we've dubbed the artist block. And that is, the goal of that is to have ground floor, you know, art galleries, but actually makers, you know, to have, you know, a glass blowing studio. But we have talked about doing something outside of town where you can have artists working. And we just haven't designed that, but that's definitely the next layer. A lot of, you know, great beach towns, they have a real strong arts program and culture. And so that is definitely something we're really excited about, adding that next layer. It's only gonna get better with time. Yeah. And that's one of the things that will really make Seabrook even more unique.
And if I can add a little bit in there, we did a Pacific Beach revitalization plan with our town planner, Lawrence Kumar, and myself and some other folks. So it's out there, and we encourage you to reach out to the county commissioners and at the county level to really kind of tell them that's what you want, rather than everything always look like it's coming from Seabrook. Like you have a vested interest as an owner of property in Pacific Beach to see it become better and more interesting. So make sure that they're using that Pacific revitalization document. That's a digital document that's out there, and they should share it with you because there's some really exciting stuff that could happen there.
Yeah. And where exactly can they find, like, is there a form or an email address that people can go to make suggestions? And
I think I would just Google it and see if it's there. That's usually what I do if I want to find, but I also have a copy on that I can.
Well, and connect with actually my mom, Robin Roloff. She has a real estate office. She has the coffee shop in Pacific Beach. She's really a promoter of downtown Pacific Beach. And so are we. There's nothing more we'd like to see than that town continue to get revitalized. And there's some great things happening there right now. It's only going to get better, but they really need a design overlay to protect, protect the community, like places like Cannon Beach and Port Townsend. They have historic design overlays to protect the integrity of the architecture, so someone can't just come in and put anything. So that's the next big step for Pacific Beach. And
tell them to hire a grant writer.
Deal. Yeah. Okay, so next question here, and we got actually a few. Are the rental properties pet friendly?
Some of them are. I'd say about half of them are pet friendly. Right. And then we have some homeowners that actually, they're hypoallergenic because they might have a child or themselves have an allergy. And so there's kind of some, just like the accessibility, the homeowners kind of shape what, you know, what these homes turn out to be to cater to their own needs first. And then it usually ends up meeting a lot of other people's needs as well.
Fantastic. And then the next question here, they first said, yay. Curious, what types of retail and restaurants are available? And how do you go about curating that list of options at Seabrook?
So again, part of the art of town building is curating our shops and our restaurants so that they're complementary to one another. We own or control the retail space on the ground floor. So we want to protect, you know, let's say the pizza place here. We've got an amazing pizza place called Frontagers. But we're not going to let another pizza place go across the street. A lot of these old main streets, sadly, they don't have the control to do that. And so it's really important to create a great town center environment. You want to make sure that it's set up where people want to go into every single store rather than, oh, we just had an ice cream cone. I don't need another one. There's five places to get an ice cream cone. So that's how we, you know, so like right now we're looking for like one thing, we need a kitchen store. We have almost 500 homes here and people love to cook out here. So like a kitchen store would do really well out here. That's just one example. You know, a glass blowing studio is one of the next things that we'd really like to add.
The jewelry store too.
A jewelry store. We have a kind of a list of businesses that we're looking for that we think fit our town well, and they are also part of a market study that was done. Some businesses have done well that really aren't even on that list, and they've kind of surprised us. But we're trying to have a list that makes it more livable here, full time.
And I guess I have time for two quick questions. Is there affordable housing for people that work in town?
There is not very much. The good news is we are building a new neighborhood in Pacific Beach, just north of Pacific Beach. We purchased 17 acres up there, and we're going to be designing a really intentional, beautiful little neighborhood that will be more affordable than Seabrook. But it's only a mile and a half away from Seabrook. So very close.
Fantastic. And then is Seabrook a strata? S-T-R-A-T-A?
I'm not sure I know what that is.
Brenda asked this, and then strata. Brenda, I'm not quite sure.
I'd love to know what it is. I don't know
what it is. Well, let's go to Google, but real quick, let's go to the last question here. This is the first time that this person has heard of Seabrook. Can you talk a little about how you buy a property there, or are the new homes for sale, or do you build to purchase?
So most, I'd say 90% of the people that buy here, they, you know, they tell us what their price point is, like what's comfortable for them. And then we have a house, you know, let's say so they want a 2-bedroom, they want a 1-bedroom, a 3-bedroom, an oceanfront house. We have pre-designed houses that have already gone through the whole design review process. And it's more of a turnkey purchase. You don't have to think too hard and work with an architect. But we also encourage people to purchase lots here and hire their own architect. I mean, part of what gives us so much diversity in Seabrook with the architecture is all the different architects that have already designed in town. And they're usually our most prominent lots are, you know, corner lots and view lots that people have purchased. So there's kind of something for everyone, you know, whether again, it's a 1-bedroom up to a 5-bedroom luxury oceanfront house. But it can be real easy, or it can be a process that someone wants to go through, design something like some of those houses we were showing you today. Those are owners that wanted to, you know, be involved in every single detail. And we love that. But there's also people that don't have the time, can't do that. And I would say that's the majority of our buyers.
Right. All right, you guys, now it's the time that everyone's been waiting for. It's time for our giveaway. 2-night stay in any available 2-bedroom home not peak season at Seabrook. And we're going to, let's do it this way. I have the attendee list. Casey, why don't you pick your favorite number 1 through 50?
12.
All right, now you're going to make me count to 12 really quick. We've got Kara Fleming.
Congratulations.
Congratulations. Yay. Number 12. And to claim your prize, the best way, we want Kara, woohoo, yeah. Do you have an email that we can give Kara?
Yes.
Or Kara, why don't you put your email in the chat and then we will reach out
to you. That would be great. That'd be great.
There we go. So you guys take Kara's email, and no one else on here email Kara unless you want to say congratulations. Thank you all so much.
And we would love to invite you to a town tour as well. If there's someone that's interested in learning more about the town, I usually give a town tour on Saturdays. And so if they want to come out and take the town tour, just give us a heads up and we'll arrange that.
Perfect. And is there anything else you want to tell our amazing viewers?
Well, I hope it's clear that we love what we're doing. You know, we love this place, and that's a big reason why people come back. And but very few people have been here, so we're always excited when people can see it for the first time. So we just, you know, hope that people can come and visit it and see what it's all about.
Great. Thank you.
Well, I know I'm coming down.
So. Okay, good.
And
we'll
if
hold you to that.
Yeah. You can go to Seabrook's website and they have an amazing rental. You can, with all these little filters and everything, so you can get exactly what you're looking for. And I hope everyone has a great day, and we'll see you next for our Team 7 presentation.
Join
great.
Us
on everybody.
Thank you,
Gina.
Thanks, everyone.
Really appreciate being on the show.
Yeah. Have a good one.
Thank you.